we did it, mirrors, magic wands, whatever, but all that counts is that we won the ball game.
My buddy was telling me he was going to throw one in the dirt one of these times.
As I get to third base, I made sure I hit the bag, and I looked back, and I saw I get by him. I have one theory in hitting, and that is thou shalt not pass without an offering, and that's what I did.
For the 1986 New York Mets, spring training began with thoughts of a championship. After two seasons of near misses, the Mets and manager Davey Johnson were well aware of what they had to do to change their fortunes.
And looking at the weaknesses of the ball club, one of them was some of our starting pitching. Last year, when we came down to that series, we really only had four starters for about the last 6 weeks because of injuries. So we felt we needed to go pick up another pitcher.
So our first conscious effort was made to get a left-handed pitcher. We made a list of them, went to Boston. We secured Bob Ojeda. The other thing I felt, we needed a right-handed hitting infielder to be able to match with Wally Bachman. We made a list of those people, made the rounds, and came up with Tim Tuffle.
Together with their returning stars, the Mets' off-season acquisitions gave St. Petersburg an air of optimism. But the spring wasn't without its setbacks.
Oh, shit! God darn it! Man, look, are you all right? Stay, just stay where you are. Did it break the glass? Oh, God, it did.
Mookie Wilson's eye injury would keep him out of action for the first month of the season, but the Mets were still confident that they would be the team to beat in the National League. On April 14th, the Mets opened the season at home after going 2-2 on the road. Teams with championship aspirations aren't supposed to get off to rocky starts. And when the Mets played sloppily and lost the opener, some people began to question the team's chances.
I think a lot of the guys were pretty upset that we were 2-3 to start, and all of a sudden, what's wrong with us? We'll never make it, and I'm going to finish second again. And they responded to it, and they just wanted to go out there and win a few games. And luckily, we went on a winning streak.
The winning streak began with a sweep of the Phillies at home as the Mets began to show the rest of the National League just what they were capable of doing.
Line drive, base hit, right center field. Mitchell scores, Mets on top, 3-2. 10 strikeouts for Gooden as he wins the second game of the year.
The Mets were on a roll, and their winning ways continued. On April 21st, they trailed the Pirates by 2 runs in the eighth, when Ray Knight came up with something to prove.
That is the most crucial at-bat of my career. I've never been higher for an at-bat. I've never wanted to do better or more in one at-bat. Davey had pinch hit for me the first night here against the Cardinals when a right-handed pitcher came in. I said, well, this is the way it's going to be. I'm going to be on platoon roll. You better accept it. So I looked back over my shoulder when I was in the on-deck circle, and I halfway expected him to pinch hit for me with a runner on first base. And he winked at me and told me I was hitting. And it was the most critical at-bat of my career. I know that Davey wanted to see what I was going to do in that situation. And I looked to hit a home run. I was swinging home run. And it's the first time in my career that I've ever wanted to hit a home run or tried to hit a home run and did.
Well hit and deep to left. This ball game is tied. Home run, Ray Knight.
I've had some great thrills, but nothing had ever compared to that singularly in a ball game.
Looking back, Davey Johnson later called Knight's at bat one of the most critical of the regular season. Not only did it help the Mets win a ball game, but it reinforced Knight's confidence as well. Then a few days later in St. Louis, the Mets prepared to battle their arch rivals, the Cardinals, and hopefully avenge last season's bitter pennant race. In the series' first game, Howard Johnson batted with the Mets down 2 runs in the ninth and turned in a performance just as critical as Knight's.
2-2 to Howard Johnson. The Mets need a long ball. They might have it. This ball is out of here, and this game is tied. Oh, my goodness. So much for faith.
It just kind of showed that the Cardinals, that we were going to be tough to beat. You know, in the previous year, they'd handle us pretty good early in the season, and we were showing them this year that we're going to handle them.
We ended up winning the ball game and sweeping them 4 straight in St. Louis. That was just a tremendous thing that we accomplished that no other team has really done, and kind of broke, you know, burst their bubble a little bit and got us going on the right foot.
Not running, and the curveball, throw to first, out at first base.
We had to establish with them that we could play with them and beat them. We'd be in the next 3 games fairly handily. And their season went down the hill after that. I think they had so much emotion in that series that after we beat them 4 straight, that just eliminated them from any kind of contention.
That's not to say that sweeping the Cardinals was easy. In fact, if not for Wally Backman, it might never have happened.
And a ground ball hit hard. Stamp, great play by Backman. The second for one. First double play. The game is over. The Mets have won the ball game. A magnificent play by Wally Backman.
In the series' final game, the newly acquired Bob Ojeda turned in his first National League complete game as the Mets beat the Cards 5-3. From there, they went on to finish the month with 13 wins and a 5-game lead over the Expos. By now, it was obvious that the Mets were loaded. Not only were Johnson's established regulars doing the job, but other new additions like Kevin Mitchell were contributing too.
Fastball hit the center field. Mitchell back to the fence. He jumps and makes the play.
Fly ball, left field and deep. Mitchell back, and he makes the catch.
Mitchell with a tough play. He won't get him, I don't believe. The throw in the dirt, he got him.
He can play center, right, left, third, short. Boy, that kid is something. He is everywhere.
While Mitchell gave the Mets added flexibility, two other players gave the team its identity. Lenny Dykstra and his fellow partner in grime, Wally Backman, led the team in dirty uniforms, playing the game with a fierce determination that became contagious.
I think all good teams grind it out, and I think it's a tribute to the character of a ball club, or to the heart of a ball club. Certainly guys like Dykstra and Backman kind of typify that kind of all-out effort and whatever it takes to win.
They lead off the top of the order, and they're both scruffy, dirty, hard-nosed, Pete Rose-type players, and I think that sets the tone.
There was nothing the Mets' dynamic duo wouldn't do for the good of the team, and while their work ethic might have been Puritan, their style was wild.
Wild boys! Wild boys! Wild boys! Wild boys!
On the night of May 27th, things got pretty wild for the rest of the Mets, too, especially Ray Knight, whose brawl with Dodger pitcher Tom Niedenfuhr branded the Mets with a reputation they would live with for the rest of the season. Around the league, opposing players and fans were infuriated with the Mets' infatuation with playing hard and winning. Two qualities which catcher Gary Carter exhibited throughout the first half of the season. As the Mets' lead in the East continued to grow, Carter set a pace which would ultimately result in his second straight 100 RBI season. Of course, it was no surprise that star players like Carter were contributing, but what made the Mets so tough early on was that everyone was contributing. On the night of June 10th, Tim Tuffle came off the bench to beat the Phillies in extra innings.
The situation was one out, bases loaded, tie ball game. So that's a perfect situation for anybody who could lift the ball into the outfield. That's all you need to do is get it far enough for a sacrifice fly.
The 2-0 delivery to Tuffle, swung on, that's the ball game! Into deep left field, that ball is gone! A grand slam home run! Timmy Tuffle has hit a grand slam home run! And the New York Mets win it 8-4. The entire dugout is out for Timmy Tuffle. A grand slam home run as a pinch hitter.
Met wins were coming from everywhere and everyone. But undoubtedly, the most consistent part of the team in 86 was its pitching. The Mets had four amazing starters, two of whom threw the ball as hard as anyone in the league, and two others who specialized in a pitch that was hard to hit.
Good fastball blows Sandberg right out of it.
Oh, that rising fastball got him.
Got him with the split finger fastball.
And again, Ojeda took something off.
The surprise of the group was Ojeda, whose 18 wins topped what came to be known as the best staff in the league.
He was very consistent through the whole season. I mean, he never really had two bad games in a row. I can't hardly remember a bad game from him. Maybe he had two all year. But he has been as dominating a pitcher as a Dwight Gooden or Ron Darling or a Sid Fernandez.
And another strikeout for Ojeda, who has struck out four of his first five batting.
Dwight Gooden, in my mind, has had an outstanding year. Some people have been disappointed in Dwight's, performances, but I certainly haven't. I felt like he's given us a very solid performance this year. And Dwight has downplayed the strikeouts, but as long as I know that he's trying to get the hitter out, I haven't been disappointed in him at all.
Ground ball to Gooden, to home, to first. Dwight Gooden with a 1-2-3 double play to end the ball game.
Sid was, I think, our toughest pitcher. He won 12 games, I think, by All-Star break, and really worked real hard to get to where he was to win the 12 games.
For Sid Fernandez, number one, the first complete game shutout of his brilliant young career. Look out, world. Here comes the kid from Hawaii.
Ron has pitched outstanding baseball all year, and his ERA has continually gone down, I think, from start to start in the second half. As long as we win the game, and we've won a great deal of his ball games, he feels real good, I think, the fact that the club wins the games that he starts, and I think that's an outstanding stat that he has.
Darling is coming to the wire like a thoroughbred. He struck out the side, and the Mets have shut out the Cup.
Then there was the bullpen, with its 1-2 punch of right-hander Roger McDowell and lefty Jesse Orozco.
We feel very fortunate that we have two strong people like a Jesse Orozco and a Roger McDowell in the pen to go to in the clutch. Jesse's thrown the ball very well, much better, I think, than what people anticipated that he would throw it for us. And Roger's had he's had a great deal of success as far as coming in with a tie game and picking up a lot of victories. They've really worked together as a great tandem there. If one isn't hot, the other one is, and I think that's been the key to our success all year.
Another key to the Mets' success was McDowell's personality, which was, well, let's say, different.
The ultimate practical joker I played with in my 12 years. Roger's got a different mask. The second half of the year, he comes to the park with around five different masks, rubber spiders, that sort of thing. He's loose, but he also dresses like he's from, he went to Dartmouth or Harvard. He's always this meticulous dresser. And he's out in the mound chewing bubblegum and blowing bubbles. It's kind of like he's got two separate personalities.
If McDowell did have two separate personalities, he sure wasn't alone. Not on the Mets.
Welcome back, my friends, to the show that never ends. We're so glad you could attend. Come inside, come inside.
They give everybody the hot foot when they wad up a big roll of matchbooks on gum and put on someone's shoe and light the matchbook. And around 2 minutes later, guy's shoe catches on fire. So those things keep you loose.
Hello, this is Roger McDowell. This is my assistant, Howard Johnson.
Hi.
On this episode, we'll introduce you to the wonderful world of Puckville.
We also want to say one thing. This is not for you kids out there to try. This is done by experienced professionals.
Come inside, the show's about to start. Guaranteed to blow your head apart.
We don't talk a lot while we're preparing.
Serious business.
It's kind of like surgery.
Surprise is the
perpetrator.
Yes.
Or the perpetrator.
Yes.
The perpetratory. And we have gum in our mouth. It's already being prepared.
Right before your eyes, we will laugh from the skies. And he laughs until he cries. And he dies, and he dies.
Move quickly.
Move quickly. Sometimes we have to go underneath the bench. St. Louis is particularly good for that because benches up high, and it's like crawling in the rice fields.
Yes.
The paddies.
Come inside, the show's about to start. Guaranteed to blow your head apart. I got to see the show. It's a dynamo.
That's amazing. How does he do it? How does he do it?
Mirrors.
Mirrors.
Now you got a very good hot foot.
Let me show you my way.
Okay.
I take the gum right out of my mouth. You know, I know it's a little
gross.
It's a little gross and a little wet and sticky, but if it, you know, it's your own gum, it's no big deal.
We like it to be known. The exhibits that were shown were exclusively our own. All our own. All our own.
I think they'll give us a raise for this.
As a team, the Mets were so hot that by the end of June, Cardinal manager Whitey Herzog had already conceded them the division title. And although it was just the beginning of the summer, a magic number watch was already posted. When the July 4th Statue of Liberty celebration lit up New York, the Mets kept in tune with the festivities. On the night of July 3rd, the Mets staged a remarkable comeback against the Houston Astros. Trailing by two runs in the bottom of the 10th, Darryl Strawberry came up with one runner on.
Well hit, way back, deep center field. Darryl Strawberry has done it again. A tremendous home run to center field. It's tied 5-5.
But the Mets didn't stop there, as Ray Knight rebounded from an awful four-strikeout night to win the game with one swing.
This ball is out of here, and this ball game is over, and I don't believe it. Ray Knight hits a game-winning home run, and the Mets have won 7 in a row. They're spreading the news that they are right now the dominant team in this game, in either league.
Unfortunately, there was a downside to being so dominant. Other teams and fans seemed to think that the Mets were arrogant and their enthusiastic curtain calls offensive.
Every good team that has a lot of success, it's always in a pennant race. They are cocky.
A lot of things have been talked about that were arrogant, that were hot dogs and a lot of things, but the fans demand the curtain calls. And the players respond in kind to it.
The curtain calls and the standing ovations and things like that, that's an emotional thing from the hometown fans of New York.
That's the only place I've played, and I would love to finish my career here.
Playing and winning in New York also had its advantages off the field. Suddenly, the Mets were all over the place, appearing in national commercials and even making the rounds on MTV with their Top of the Charts music video. But despite their national celebrity, the Mets really belong to New York.
You belong to the city. You belong to the night. Living in a river of darkness. In
While the Mets loved playing for the hometown fans at Shea, one place they didn't care for was Houston, especially in the second week of July when the Mets went into the Dome and left town with three straight losses. The Mets had entered the All-Star break with a 13-game lead, the largest since divisional play began in 1969. But after the break, the Mets experienced frustration for the first time all season. The situation then took a turn for the worse when four Mets were involved in an unfortunate incident with off-duty police at a popular Houston night spot. The Mets couldn't get out of Houston soon enough, and their fortunes improved in a bizarre game in Cincinnati, thanks to a two-out gift in the top of the ninth.
Parker going back. Make no, he grabs the ball! Both runs score! Hernandez to second, and the game is tied!
From then on, the evening took an even stranger twist, especially when Ray Knight engaged in his second altercation of the year and really caused some problems.
Both benches ebbing as we see fights breaking out around.
I kind of protested the ball game because I didn't think it was fair for a guy to come off their bench and get in a fight with one of my regular players. I'd already made a number of moves to get it back in the ball game, so I now only had seven everyday players. So I had to put a pitcher in the outfield, and so I used my two short men. Both of them are good athletes, and also wanted to do it too. Because I'd seen Whitey Herzog do it earlier in the year with a left-hander in Morrell, and I thought it would be interesting to try.
Interesting to try and interesting to watch, as both McDowell and Orozco proved that they could do more than just pitch. Meanwhile, there were other Mets playing out of position too, like the 80th third baseman in Mets history, Gary Carter, who played a part in a patented Keith Hernandez play which helped save the game.
Those plays, there's a runner on first and second, I don't have to hold a runner on. And that particular play, it was a pitcher that was just called up. He's probably nervous to death. I just more or less took it for granted. Well, I didn't take it for granted. I knew that he was going to bunt. There was no doubt in my mind that he was going to do anything but bunt. He did, and I was right there on top of the play. He didn't get it down the third base line enough. To get it by me, they had to hit it hard down the third base line, and I take that away, and it's an easy two.
After Keith's easy two, Howard Johnson's three-run homer in the top of the 14th inning put the Mets ahead to stay. And when McDowell came in from right field to get the game's final out, the Mets had a routine 6-3 win. The comeback in Cincinnati was the type of win which typified the Mets' year, and it helped to reduce their magic number even further by the end of July. By August 6th, the Mets' lead had grown to 18 games, but they still didn't stand still. Left fielder George Foster, who had contributed early, was released. And former Met Lee Mazzilli returned home and promptly got into the swing of things.
Here's a drive off Mazzilli's bat. Gone, Lee Mazzilli! And they love him even more at Shea Stadium now.
Mazzilli's return to New York was just as heartwarming as the return of Mookie Wilson to everyday play, especially after he had temporarily lost his job to Lenny Dykstra.
The good thing about the whole situation was that the Mets did find a new dimension in myself, being a little more versatile than they probably thought I was. Overall, my play, I think I've been very satisfied with it. I've learned a lot. I've learned a little bit about what I am capable of doing, you know, if I wanted to, and some things that I really have to work on that I found that I'm not capable of doing. But that's what this year has been for me. It's a year of learning and progress.
The Mets' progress might have taken a turn for the worse when Gary Carter injured his thumb. But thanks to Ed Hearn, the Mets never broke stride. Hearn started 11 games during Carter's time on the disabled list, and the Mets won 8 of them, actually increasing their lead over their closest rivals. One ironic aspect of Carter's injury was that it focused more attention on Keith Hernandez. After slumping through much of the summer, Hernandez knew he'd be called on to pick up the slack after Carter was hurt. And true to form, he did. Not only with his play on the field, but with his guidance and leadership off it as well.
Keith is a tremendous leader on the ball club. He still plays hard, he tries hard, and he's always pumping up other players. He's very much the glue on the infield. You can call him inspirational leader or whatever you want to call him, but he is a presence that has to be reckoned with. And he's still a clutch hitter, even when he's going bad. You always feel that Keith is going to get the job done when you need it done. And under the most trying circumstances, he's going to be the guy that comes through. And he's been that kind of player for me really all year.
Cruz with a ground ball. It's a fair ball, and Hernandez has got it. Woo! The throw is in time. What a play. Look at Hernandez. A Golden Glove first baseman makes a Golden Glove play.
Of course, Hernandez wasn't alone when it came to providing the Mets with leadership and character. Both Keith and Gary Carter were players the others could look up to.
They both have a lot of pride, intense pride, and that drives them a long way. They both really enjoy playing the game. Gary's a little more effervescent than Keith is, but they're both tremendous professionals, and they're both probably going to be Hall of Fame players, and it's a joy to have them both on the club at the same time.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright, my walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light, and I held firm. What I felt was right, like a rock, like a rock. I was strong as I could be, like a rock. Nothing ever got to me, like a rock. I was something to see, like a rock.
One thing leadership can help provide is stability on the road. And in 86, the Mets played well there, winning 53 games, sometimes in especially memorable ways, like a game in late August against the Padres.
Ground ball, swept the middle. Templeton's coming around to score. Flannery to second, the throw, out at home. He's out at home. The throw to third, out at third. The Mets win it 6-5. What a double play. Just your routine double play.
So as August drew to a close, the Mets had a 19-game lead over the Phils, and their magic number was down to 14. September, then, was a time to count the days to the inevitable. Or maybe to have some fun, as the Mets did in an exhibition game with the Red Sox. For Gary Carter, the meeting provided an opportunity to test out the Green Monster, just in case he would be making the trip north to Boston again later on in the year. After their short break from the daily grind, the Mets traveled to Philadelphia with the Eastern Division title finally within their grasp. And knowing that it was just a matter of time, Met fans were ready.
How does that feel in a visiting ballpark?
That's everywhere we go. It's like this. They're crazy.
Crazy, but disappointed. At least that's the way Met fans felt in Philadelphia, as they saw their team lose all three games to the Phillies when just one win would have given the Mets the division title. Actually, the Mets might have been doing their fans a favor, because losing in Philadelphia meant that the clinching would have to come in New York. With the champagne on ice, the Mets put the ball in the capable hands of Dwight Gooden. And the Doc quickly let people know that September 17th would indeed be a night to remember. While Gooden shut down the Cubs, the Mets found some hidden offense from a new source. Rookie Dave Magadan filled in for a flu-ridden Keith Hernandez and drove in two runs with three hits. The Mets took a 4-2 lead into the top of the ninth. And as Shea Stadium rocked with anticipation, the time to celebrate finally arrived.
Ground ball to the right side of the infield. Backman has it to Hernandez. Mets win. It's over. Keith Hernandez took the throw. And oh, my goodness.
Couldn't even see you on the field.
I just didn't want to screw up.
Oh. I've been waiting 13 years, and now that it's happened.
It's been a great year all the way.
Oh, this is the biggest thrill right here.
Oh, boy, he did an outstanding job.
This is the most excitement in my life.
Come on, Roger, come on.
I'm really enjoying it. And you deserve some champagne.
I think I do, too, and why?
Although they were anxious to get on with the playoffs, the Mets first needed to finish the regular season. And that came on October 5th when they won their record 108th game. It was a fitting way to complete the celebration of the team's 25th anniversary, a year in which Met fans were given the opportunity to remember the lovable team of 1962 and the amazing one of 1969. 1986 was also a year that the Mets honored Rusty Staub and set a New York City sports attendance record of 2.76 million fans, all of whom were ready to root the Mets on in the playoffs. On October 8th, the Mets began their second season in Houston against the Astros. To a man, the team was confident yet cautious, considering they were facing an Astro pitching staff that had been nearly unbeatable the last month of the season. The Mets, though, had been waiting for this night for a long time, and with the Astros and their fans equally as excited, the series was set to begin. Mike Scott was on the mound for the Astros. The ace of Houston's staff quickly showed the Mets just why he led the league in strikeouts during the year. Scott's split-fingered fastball was almost unhittable, and he took the sting out of the Mets' vaunted attack by striking out 14 in a tense 1-0 win over Dwight Gooden. Down a game, the Mets were keenly aware of just how disastrous a loss would be in Game 2. Especially pitcher Bob Ojeda.
I was thinking a win's pretty important right about now. I think on days like that, on days when you know we were heading against the wall, we weren't against it yet. Every one of us reached back for maybe a little bit extra.
A breaking ball tapped out in front. Runners coming. Ojeda tags him himself. Got him on the head.
Ojeda's play kept the Astros from scoring first, and the way Nolan Ryan was pitching, that was important.
The first three innings, he shut us down again. And he was looking tough. And then the guys, you know, just a little chip in the armor. And the guys, you know, came through.
This ball hit into right center field. It's deep right center. It is off of the wall. Backman held at second. Now coming around. He comes on in. The throw gets away in the infield. As Gary Carter gets his first hit of the series.
Just a tremendous sigh. Like, there. Now we're okay. We broke the ice and then went out and we got three the next inning as well, with two outs.
Line to right center field, it'll be extra base hit. Just on by the diving Hatcher, two runs to score. Hernandez on his way to third. And the throw to third base does not come off as Hernandez triples the drive in two more.
The Mets bats had exploded for five runs in two innings. And with Ojeda keeping the Astros off balance all night long, Game 2 belonged to the Mets, 5-1, and the series was even at one apiece. By winning a game in the Dome, the Mets had accomplished what they'd set out to do, and as they made their way back to New York, they were extremely confident that the series would end at Shea. But the excitement and euphoria of the Mets' first postseason home game in 13 years wore off quickly, as Ron Darling was roughed up early. Led by Bill Doran's two-run homer in the second inning, the Astros jumped out to a 4-0 lead. But the Mets fought back, scoring once in the sixth and leaving two on for Darryl Strawberry.
Lenny was telling me on the bench that I was going to have to hit a home run to get us back in this ball game. He was struggling a little bit that inning. He wanted to get ahead in the count. If he was going to get ahead in the count, he was going to throw me breaking balls after that. So I was looking for fastball.
High fly ball, hit deep to right field, way back, maybe, going, gone, home run!
With one sudden swing, the Mets had drawn even. But just as suddenly, they again fell behind in the next inning. The score remained 5-4 Astros until the bottom of the ninth, when Wally Backman led off with a drag bunt. The Astros contended that Backman ran out of the base path, but the umpires disagreed. And after Houston manager Hal Lanier lost his argument, Backman went to second on a wild pitch. Knowing full well that the Mets needed a hit to tie, general manager Frank Cashin and the rest of the Shea Stadium crowd waited uneasily as Lenny Dykstra stepped to the plate to face the Astros' Dave Smith with one out and the tying run at second.
Lenny Dykstra, the man they call Nails on the Mets ball club, is waiting. Now the pitch,
And a high fly ball hit the right field. It is fairly deep. It's way back by the wall.
He did it! It's a home run! A home run! The Mets win the ball game! Dykstra hits a home run! Lynn Dykstra hit a home run! This ball game is over! Lenny Dykstra being mobbed by his teammates.
I was very happy. I had my rally hat on in my den. I jumped up and I gave a high five to my brother. It was great.
Let's go, Mets! Let's go, Mets!
Unfortunately for the Mets, the happiness of the previous afternoon was wiped out quickly by Mike Scott in Game 4. As he did in the first game, Scott continued his mastery over the Mets, who by now seemed more concerned about the possibility that Scott threw a scuffed ball than they did about hitting the pitch. Any way you looked at it, Scott was simply too tough, and the series was tied at 2 games each after the Astros' 3-1 win. The Astros' win in Game 4 had guaranteed them a trip back home to Houston, and after rain postponed Game 5 for a day, the Mets took the field knowing that a win was an absolute necessity. On the mound for the Mets was their ace, Dwight Gooden, who pitched brilliantly for 10 innings, giving up just one run. But Gooden's effort was matched by the ageless Nolan Ryan, who pitched brilliantly himself.
He has retired every batter to face him, and we're now in the fifth inning. 13 consecutive hitters have been set down. Drive it hard down the right field line. It may go foul. Watching, and it's a fair ball. Home run! Home run!
From that point on, the tension at Shea was nearly unbearable. As the two teams staged an epic battle, no one could break through. No one could deliver the one clutch hit that would turn the series in their favor. In the 11th, the Mets took Gooden out and brought in Jesse Orozco. And as he did in his Game 3 win, Orozco shut down the Astros with little trouble, this time in the 11th and 12th. Finally, in the bottom of the 12th, the Mets broke through. But it took a mistake by reliever Charlie Kerfeld to get them going. With Wally Backman on first, Kerfeld threw away a pickoff attempt and Backman scrambled to second. The next batter was to be Keith Hernandez, but there was little chance he would get to hit, especially with Gary Carter mired in a horrendous postseason slump.
The intentional walk, and I'm saying this is the ideal situation to break him out.
Kid is definitely a money player. I wanted him, Keith or Gary, to be up there in that situation with somebody that's on in scoring position.
The most important thing is to keep your head up and try and maintain the confidence. And you know, 1-for-21. I mean, I'm not getting an 0-50 hitter.
And a ground ball, base hit through the middle. Backman around third. Backman coming home. The throw. He scores. The Mets win. The Mets win.
So the Mets went back to Houston for Game 6 and brought a few fans with them.
Let's go, Mets! Tonight's the night!
Who's going to win tonight?
I think Mets? The Astros.
Astros?
Ah, come on!
Mets!
Meanwhile, back in New York, it seemed like the whole city was watching the game. Although no one rooting for the Mets could have been very encouraged after the Astros exploded for 3 runs in the bottom of the first. Once again, the Mets were having trouble scoring runs, and this time Bob Nepper was the reason why. Right from the start, Nepper frustrated the Mets, and as each inning passed and the Astros held on to their lead, the Mets were left to wonder whether or not they might ever get another hit. By the time the 9th inning rolled around, there was little reason to believe that the Mets would solve the mystery of Nepper.
Mets have had only 2 hits. Game 7 would be tomorrow night. The pitchers would be Ron Darling and Mike Scott.
But suddenly, with the rally caps back in New York working their magic, the Mets erupted.
And a high fly hit the right center field. On the run, on the run, on the run. Hatcher, Dykstra around second, racing for third. He's in standing with a triple. Infield back, the Astros have a 3-run lead. and a soft line drive to second. Base hit. Dykstra in to score. It's 3-1. The tying run will be coming to bat. The pitch. And a fly ball well hit to right center. Billy Hatcher on the run. On the run, way back. Can't get it. Base hit. Over his head. Wilson around third. Mookie will score. 3-2. And the tying run on second. A pitching change will be made. Dave Smith is coming on in relief. The pitch. Fly ball well hit to right center field. The game will be tied up. Hernandez will score. Tie ball game. Ray Knight has tied it up.
As Game 6 moved into extra innings, Roger McDowell pitched 5 scoreless innings to keep the game tied until the Mets finally went ahead in the 14th.
Mets looking for the biggest hit of the year right here. And a line drive base hit going into right field. Strawberry will try to score. Here's the throw coming to the plate. He scores! The Mets have taken the lead.
The pennant was just 3 outs away, but the Astros' Billy Hatcher wouldn't cooperate.
4-3 New York, bottom half of the 14th inning. Now the pitch on the way. And a high fly deep to left, down the line. It may go foul, waiting. It hits the screen. Tie ball game, home run.
I said to myself, it's a home run. There's nothing I can do about it. The game's not over and we haven't lost, so I'm still in it. And I still had 2 more guys to get out that inning.
Orozco got those 2 guys. And then in the 16th, with no out and Darryl Strawberry on second, Ray Knight came to the plate.
I asked him, I said, do you want me to bunt him over or you want me to drive him in or what? And he says, I want you to hit the ball to right field and drive him in. So I never thought of anything but hitting it to right field.
Line drive, base hit to right field. Strawberry may have trouble scoring. The throw is coming in, won't get him. The run is in. Knight to second base. The Mets are in front, 5-4.
The Mets scored twice more in the top of the 16th to lead 7-4, but the Astros rallied once again, scoring 2 runs off a tired Jesse Orozco to cut the Mets' lead to 1. Then, with 2 out and the tying and winning runs on base, Orozco had to face the dangerous Kevin Bass.
I said to myself, if I walk him, I still have a left-handed batter up next. That could be to my advantage. I wasn't going to give in or anything. But I said to myself, I have a chance. I'll try to get him, but I'm going to throw breaking balls.
This is heart-stopping baseball, pulsating baseball. Nobody has sat down in the last 4 or 5 innings. Incredible. Now the stretch. The pitch on the way. Swing and a miss! Swing and a miss! Struck him out! Struck him out! Mets win it! The Mets have won it. They're in the World Series. Oh, they are mobbing Jesse Orozco.
So it was on to the World Series, which kicked off with a star-studded gala party the night before the first game. The next day began the more serious business of crowning a world champion. Shea Stadium, of course, was peppered with celebrities, who, along with everyone else, anticipated a classic matchup between the Mets and the Boston Red Sox, the 2 teams that most experts considered the best in baseball. Like the Mets, the Sox, too, had just completed a dramatic and exhausting playoff series. But when the game got underway, it was the Mets who seemed the worse for wear. Part of the reason was Bruce Hurst, who very neatly tied the Mets up in knots all night long. Fortunately for the Mets, they were getting good pitching too. Ron Darling rebounded from his shaky playoff performance of a week earlier and kept the score even by shutting out the Sox through 6 innings. But in the 7th, with Jim Rice on second, the Sox got a break.
Edmund steps in with 1 down. The pitch, ground ball to second. Tuffle has a go between his legs. Strawberry picks it up. Here comes Rice. Throw coming to the plate to Carter. Not in time. Throw to second. Not in time. Red Sox lead.
That lone run was the difference as the Sox won the series opener. The next night, the stars were really out at Shea. First, Billy Joel sang the national anthem, and then Dwight Gooden faced off against Roger Clemens in a classic duel between 2 of the hardest throwers in baseball. but the anticipated matchup between Gooden's smoke and Clemens' fire turned out to be a false alarm as the Sox pounded out 18 hits in a 9-3 drubbing of the Mets to go up 2-0. Only once before had a team come back to win a series after losing the first 2 games at home. So as the series shifted to Boston, the Mets had their backs to the wall in more ways than one. But the 86 Mets were a team of character, and one could almost sense that things were about to change as Lenny Dykstra led off the game.
Well, hit fly ball down the right field line. Will it stay fair? If it does, it's gone. There it goes. Home run. Home run for Lenny Dykstra. Line drive toward the gap, left center field. Base hit rolling all the way back to the wall. Backman is coming home. Hernandez is going to third. Carter to second. 4 consecutive hits. 2-0, New York. Now the stretch by Oil Can, the pitch. Ground ball hit down to third. The play will be at the plate. Into a rundown goes Keith Hernandez. They throw. 2 people are on third. Carter's trying to get back to second. And Hernandez is staying at third. The slide. Save. He got back. Oh, Carter got back.
Oh, did they blow that one.
Before they were through, the Mets would go on to score 4 runs in the first, a lead that Bobby Ojeda protected by pitching masterfully against his former teammates. When the game was over, the reborn Mets had a 7-1 win, but were still down a game with 2 more to go in Boston. The Mets' lopsided win had lifted much of the pressure off a team that had been struggling, and the smiles were out again the next night when Boston pitcher Al Nipper began to unravel against Gary Carter in a scoreless game in the top of the fourth.
Nipper comes to the belt, pitch. Swung on, hit high in the air, deep to left field, way back at the wall, goodbye home run! Gary Carter, a 2-run homer.
With Ron Darling shutting down the Sox again, Lenny Dykstra helped the Mets put the game out of reach in the seventh.
Livery swung on, hit in the air to right field, fairly deep. Evans going back, way back near the wall, jumping up, and can't get it! A home run, Lenny Dykstra! Delivery, Carter hits it high and deep, say goodbye, home run!
Carter's second homer capped off the Mets' series-tying 6-2 win and shifted the pressure back to the Red Sox, who had to win Game 5 at home against Dwight Gooden. But Gooden was pitching on only 3 days' rest, and for the second time in the series, his best stuff deserted him. The Sox scored a run each in the second and third innings, and then broke the game open in the fifth. First, Jim Rice tripled, and soon after, he was driven in by Don Baylor, as Boston knocked Gooden out of the game and went on to win 4-2 behind Bruce Hurst to take a 3-2 lead in the series. The Mets, though, had done what they had to do by winning twice in Boston, and now were confident about the prospects of playing the last 2 games before their vocal home crowd. Even though one fan tried a unique way of rallying the Mets, the Sox still jumped out to an early 2-0 lead and had their ace, Roger Clemens, on the mound, who had the Mets on the ropes until the fifth inning.
The pitch, and a ground ball hit toward the middle. Base hit to center field. Strawberry around third, coming home to score. It's 2-1.
A few batters later, the Mets had tied the score, but it didn't stay that way for too long.
2-2, top of the seventh. 1-1 count. They deliver to Rice, swung on, a ground ball to third. Knight will hold the runner. Throws the high to first. Hernandez can't get it out of his glove. And moving up to third base is Barrett. An error on Ray Knight.
But the Mets rallied once more in the eighth. With runners on second and third and one out, the Sox walked Keith Hernandez intentionally.
Hernandez giving Carter the clenched fist as he walks down to first base, saying, come and get it, baby. Fans on their feet here at Shea. Bases loaded, one down. Red Sox lead 3-2. Swung on, hit in the air to left field. It'll be caught, runner tags. Here comes Mazzilli. Here comes the throw to the plate. Not in time. The game is tied at 3-3.
So it was on to extra innings where the tension was unreal.
For people to sit still the way this game is going. By far and away the most intense game of the World Series. Now the windup, the pitch to Henderson. Well hit. Deep to left field. Way back going. Gone, a home run. The Red Sox are in front, 4-3.
Boston scored once more to take a 2-run lead into the bottom of the 10th. With the Sox champagne about to be popped, a silent Shea crowd watched in disbelief.
Now the pitcher on the way, hit in the air. Rice is there and has it for the out. And the Red Sox are 2 outs away from a championship. And a fly ball to center. Henderson going back under it now. He has it, two men down. Everybody sitting very quietly in that New York Mets dugout, hoping against hope that something will start to happen. Line drive, it'll be a base hit to left field. And a line drive, base hit into center field. Now the tying runs are on base. A soft line drive, it'll be a base hit in the center field. Carter will score. Mitchell will go to third. A base hit by Ray Knight. The pitch gets away. Gets away. Here comes Mitchell. Here comes Mitchell. Tie game. By Stanley, and a ground ball trickling. It is a fair ball. It's by Buckner. Rounding third night. The Mets will win the ball game. The Mets win.
Incredibly, almost implausibly, the Mets were still alive, and their entire season had now come down to a single game. After shutting down the Red Sox twice, Ron Darling was called on to pitch, but the Sox got to him early.
The payoff pitch, well hit fly ball, deep to left center, way back, going and gone. The pitch on the way, high fly, deep to right center, way back, Strawberry to the wall, jumping, and he caught it. No! Couldn't get it. It's a home run.
The Sox scored once more in the second and then put the ball in the capable left hand of Bruce Hurst, who had already beaten the Mets twice in the series and was on his way towards doing it again. But before the Sox could put the game away, Davey Johnson went to his bullpen and replaced Darling with Sid Fernandez, whose four strikeout effort in just 2 1/3 innings got the Mets and the Shea Stadium crowd going. Finally, in the sixth, the Mets got a rally going. With one out, Lee Mazzilli pinch hit a single, and Mookie Wilson followed with one of his own. Then, after a walk to Tim Tuffle, Keith Hernandez came up with the bases loaded, and the Mets in desperate need of a hit.
And a line drive, base hit, going in the gap in left center. Mazzilli will score. Rounding third is Mookie. Mookie will score. 3-2. 3-2.
One batter later, the Mets tied the game. And when Red Sox manager John McNamara decided to change pitchers in the bottom of the seventh, his choice was his number one reliever. And as a haunting chant filled the stadium, Calvin Schiraldi faced Ray Knight.
Now the windup and the delivery, swung on, hit in the air, fairly deep to left field, going back near the wall, looking up, goodbye! Home run, Ray Knight! The Mets lead 4-3!
The Mets scored twice more in the inning to go up by 3 runs. But with Roger McDowell now pitching in relief of Fernandez, the Sox came right back.
Delivery swung on, hit in the air. That's going to be a base hit into right center field. All the way back to the wall. It is a 6-5 ball game.
Jesse Orozco came in to pitch the Mets out of the jam. And in the bottom of the eighth, Darryl Strawberry put the series away.
Swung on, hit in the air to right field. Fairly deep. Evans going back at the wall. Goodbye, home run! Darryl Strawberry! 7-5, New York!
The Mets had exploded for 8 runs in just 3 innings, and the crowd let the Red Sox know what that was all about. The time had come. The Mets were now just one out away from winning a memorable World Series. Just 2 days before, the Red Sox had been in the very same position, but the Mets weren't about to let the same thing happen to them.
He struck him out! Struck him out! The Mets have won the World Series! And they're jamming and crowding all over Jesse Orozco. The dream has come true. The Mets have won the World Series, coming from behind to win the seventh ball game.
And so it was over. The Mets were world champions. They had turned their silver anniversary into a series of golden moments. As it had all season, the Mets' character came through in the end and took them to the top in a year to remember.